Amen. Amen. All right. What a joy to be in the house of the Lord this morning and be back here among God's people and ready to get into God's Word. Let's take our Bibles and turn to the Gospel of John, chapter 8 this morning. We're going to continue making our way down to the end of John, chapter 8. And Lord willing, we're going to finish this chapter this morning. And I promise, I know that many of you are concerned. I know that the Cowboys start at noon today. But I promise I'm just going to say what the Lord wants me to say, right? Amen, Brother Greg? All right, and you know what? We might take a knee today, but it'll be before our Lord Jesus Christ, right? All right, so let's go to the book of John chapter 8, beginning in verse 51. The Bible says, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, if a man keep my saying, he shall never see death. Then said the Jews unto him, Now we know that thou hast a devil. Abraham is dead, and the prophets. And thou sayest, if a man keep my saying, he will never taste death. Art thou greater than our father Abraham, which is dead, and the prophets who are dead? Whom makest thou thyself? Jesus answered, If I honored myself, my honor is nothing. It is my Father that honoreth me, of whom ye say that he is your God. Yet ye have not known him, but I know him. And if I should say I know him not, I shall be a liar like unto you. But I know him and keep his saying. Your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad. Then said the Jews unto him, Thou art not yet 50 years old, and thou hast seen Abraham? Jesus said unto them, Verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am. Then took they up stones to cast at him, but Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple, going through the midst of them, and so passed by. Father, today we've read your word. Now we want to be faithful to it. We want to be faithful to the truth of your word. Lord, help us to study it with open hearts, Lord, and open our hearts to understand it. God, we pray, Lord, because we know, Lord, that when we read your word, it's you speaking to us. Father, we pray that you'll help us understand what you're saying today. Father, if there's somebody here this morning that doesn't know you as Savior, I pray, Father, today that you'll reach out and touch their hearts by the power of your Holy Spirit. They might come to you, Father. Lord, also we pray, Father, for some Christian who's, Lord, maybe walked away from you, maybe walking in their own way, that today, Lord, they'll hear your voice and come back home, Lord, while there's time. We pray, Father, that you'll forgive us our sins and that you'll bless this message and use it for your glory. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen. Amen. So we study through this final section of John chapter 8 this morning. We're looking at the closing words in a very unpleasant confrontation. An argument, a dispute between Jesus and the religious leaders of Israel. These guys are the preachers. These are the pastors, the ones that Israel looked up to be their spiritual leaders, and they are opposed to Jesus. They just don't get it. They are opposed to the very Son of God. This conflict's been heating up more and more because Jesus has been doing two things. First, he's been showing the people that he is the Son of God, very God himself, come down from heaven to be the Savior. They don't want to believe that. Secondly, he's been confronting the wickedness of these men, these false spiritual leaders. He's been exposing them as the hypocrites, the phonies that they are. And these men that Jesus is confronting here, they are addicted to glory. They love receiving honor from men. They always desire to be in the spotlight, to be the center of attention. But Jesus has taken the people's attention away from them. Jesus, because of the awesomeness of his presence, the people are now looking at him. Jesus working his miracles, Jesus' words, the people are looking at him instead of looking at the Pharisees and the religious leaders of Israel. They want to be the center of attention, but Jesus has taken that away from them because of how awesome he is. And he is because also that he has so publicly confronted them and embarrassed them and pointed out the wickedness in their lives, they're growing more and more frustrated with him to the point that now they've resorted, we've studied it the last few weeks, they have resorted to name calling and they're shouting insults at him like children in a schoolyard. They're saying, they're using the your mama thing, you know, like we talked about the last few weeks. We saw them doing that. Your mom was a fornicator. Where is your father? They've said those kinds of things to Jesus. And as we come this morning to the end of the confrontation here in John chapter 8, I want you to notice four things that stand out in this passage. First of all, I want you to see the sadness of undesired love. Jesus is reaching out to these guys with a great loving invitation. And I want you to see this in verse 51. He said, and they have been horrible to Jesus, okay? Understand, that's the background here. They've been insulting him. They've been rejecting him. They've been arguing with him, disputing with him. But in verse 51, Jesus reaches out with these very kind words. He says, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, if a man keep my saying, he shall never see death." All right? Keeping in mind, these men are extremely angry with Jesus. They're making plans in their heart to murder him. They want to kill Jesus. And I want you to think about how amazing it is that Jesus is making a statement like this to them. After everything that they've been doing to him, do we act like that? I can remember one time when I first became a youth pastor here at this church, and I took a couple of kids, a couple of the young people in the youth group, I took them to Burger King. I knew they were hungry. They had been at the hospital with me. I knew they were hungry. And so I took them to Burger King. And we were sitting there at the table eating, and I bought them dinner, you know, and we're sitting there at the table, and one of the kids is just sitting there quiet, and I said, "You okay?" And she looked at me, and she said, she mentioned the last youth pastor that we had here before me, and she said, "You are not him, and you will never be." And I wanted to say right then, I was saying, "Okay, give me back that hamburger, and I'll eat it." That's kind of the way that we are when somebody does something to us, you know, when somebody says something rotten to us. These guys were being horrible to Jesus, and what does Jesus do? He's offering them an invitation. "Verily, verily, I say to you, if you keep my saying, you will never..." I am offering you guys a way to escape death and hell. They've tried to discredit him. They've insulted him. They've called him a liar. They've attacked the character and the virtue of his earthly mother and father. They did the "your mom, your daddy" thing. They've accused him of being demon-possessed and working his miracles through the power of the devil. They've done everything they could and said everything they could to show that they hate him very much. But guys, even after everything they've done to him, Jesus still responds to them with this kind, loving invitation to believe in him and receive everlasting life. "If a man keep my saying, he shall never see death." He's still reaching out to them regardless of their hatred and their nastiness. He's still reaching out to them with this loving invitation to come to him and trust him and be saved. And boy, when we look at this, we can see that Jesus not only, when he said, "Love your enemies," we see that he not only preached this, but he practiced what he preached. He did love his enemies. And we can look at this and know that he practiced it. But I want you to watch the way that these guys respond to that love. Because Jesus is saying, "Guys, I want to give you an opportunity now to have life in my name." And here's how they responded to that kind invitation. In verse number 52, "Then said the Jews to him, now we know that thou hast the devil." And you see, Jesus has just said one of the kindest things possible. He's just offered them the greatest, kindest gift possible, and they're all still shouting insults at him. They're accusing him of having the devil in him. And listen to their arguments. Jesus said to them, "If a man keep my saying, he shall never see death." And here's what they argue in verse 52. "Then said the Jews to him, now we know that thou hast the devil. Abraham is dead, and the prophets, and thou sayest, if a man keep my saying, he shall never taste of death." Okay, now, obviously, we know that everybody dies physically, okay? Everybody, there's two people in the Bible, Enoch, who walked with God and was not, for God took him. There's Elijah, who went up in a chariot of fire. These two are the only two I know of in the Scripture. Even Jesus died a physical death, right? We know that people, one out of one, that's the statistic, one out of one dies, right? We're all heading, it is appointed unto men once to die. And I honestly believe, you know, and we read about it in the tribulation, I believe that Enoch and Elijah will probably come back and be those two prophets. And they're going to die in the streets too, but they're going to be raised back up. And so, everybody physically dies. And these guys are jumping on that fact, and they're saying, wait a minute, are you telling us that if we put our faith in you, we will never die? Abraham died, all the prophets died. How can you tell us that we'll never die? And you see, the problem with these false religious leaders is that they always had their minds tied up in the here and now, right here in this life. And they had a problem with thinking eternally. They never could think eternally. Jesus never said anything about saving them from physical death. He's talking about saving them from spiritual death. He's talking about saving them from the second death. And even those who grow up when Christ comes, they're going to be changed. It says in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, they're going to be changed. But Jesus never says anything. What he's talking about here is saving them, not from physical death, but saving them from spiritual, eternal death. The second death. Revelation chapter 21 and verse number 8 says, the fearful and unbelieving and the abominable and murderers and whoremongers and sorcerers and idolaters and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. That's what Jesus is talking about. He's not talking about saving them from physical death. He's talking about the eternal death that takes place in the lake of fire. The second death. Revelation 20 and verse number 6 says, blessed and holy is he that hath part in the first resurrection. On such the second death has no power. That's what Jesus is talking about. Guys, Jesus is reaching out to these guys with love and compassion. He's offering to save them from eternal spiritual death in the lake of fire. And if they'll just believe in him, he's offering to give them eternal life in heaven. But these guys are throwing it away. They're tossing it right back in Jesus' face. And that is a sad thing. Tragic. Verse 53. They said, art thou greater than our father Abraham, which is dead, and the prophets are dead? Whom makest thou thyself? Who are you claiming to be? And basically what they're saying to Jesus is that he's just making up these claims about himself just to get attention and to glorify himself. Abraham couldn't save anybody from death, and the prophets couldn't save anybody from death. And so you must be making these claims up just to get attention for themselves. Now, they would have recognized that because that's what these guys did. They did everything they could to get attention for themselves. They chose the best seats at the meetings, and they wanted the utmost place in the temple. The Bible says, Jesus told them in Matthew 23, you can read it sometimes, that they would enlarge the borders of their garments. In other words, they would put on the fancy clothes, and they would try to make themselves look so spiritual. They would make broad their phylacteries. In other words, they wore these boxes on their heads where they put scriptures in them all the time. And the bigger their box, the more spiritual they were, because they had more scriptures in their boxes up there. Better put scripture in your heart, not in a box on your head. And so they're accusing Jesus of just trying to get attention, of trying to look special. And of course, we know that Jesus was talking to them about a spiritual reality. Not that he's going to save them from physical death, but he can save them from the second death. Whoever keeps his word, though he may pass through the experience of physical death, there is an eternal life in heaven on the other side of that. Remember what Jesus said in John chapter 11 and verse 25, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. 46 years that I've been living is not very long. I've seen a lot of people die. I want to tell you, there is a huge difference between when a Christian dies and when a non-believer dies, goes out into eternity. Because the message of the cross, believed in the heart, removes the sting of death. Oh, death, where is thy sting? It removes the sting of death. We can walk through the valley of the shadow of death and fear no evil because we know he's with us. And we're going to be with him. So Jesus is just reaching out to these guys with this loving invitation to come to him, believe in him, receive the gift of forgiveness of sins and eternal life. But they hate him, and they're just throwing it right back in his face, and that is the saddest part of the story. But secondly, in this passage, I want you to notice the sincerity of unwanted laurels, the sincerity of undesired laurels. Verse number 53, I asked him, art thou greater than our father Abraham, which is dead, and the prophets are dead? Whom makest thou thyself? Just who are you claiming to be? They're asking him. Verse 54, Jesus answered, if I honor myself, my honor is nothing. All right, what does Jesus mean by that? Let me see if I can give you an illustration. My son Daniel is back there somewhere. I saw him earlier. There he is, back there on the very back row. Rebellious on the back row. All the rest of you rebellious back row Baptists. My son Daniel has several trophies in his room at home. He spent 4 years taking karate classes. And during that time, every few months, Daniel would go up to the school for a test. Mr. Miyagi would watch him go through all his different forms, do all his kicks, do all his punches. He would break boards, he broke bricks. Some pretty cool stuff. At the end of that belt test, if he did everything right, then Mr. Miyagi would give him a new belt. It'd be a different color, be a higher level. You did good, you've advanced. He'd give him a higher level. And sometimes his teacher would give him a trophy as well. Sometimes his teacher would give him a trophy, and that trophy only went to one person in that class. And that trophy said, best student in class. There were a few times that Daniel got that. I know I'm surprised too, okay? A couple times Daniel got that. And you know what? That really meant something. It meant something for us as a family to watch our son work hard, do well at something like that, especially the day when he got his black belt. Daniel went in there, took that test. It was a tough thing. He did a lot of tough stuff. That was a big accomplishment. And those belts and that trophy, that was something that was very significant. But just imagine with me this morning that maybe one day I'm walking through Daniel's room and I'm looking at all Daniel's trophies and I just stick my bottom lip out and I just, you know what, I don't have any trophies. This is just not fair that my kid has all these trophies and I don't have any trophies. But you know what, I get an idea, it's okay. There is a store over here on Camp Bowie. And I can just drive over there and I can buy all the trophies that I want to buy for myself. And so I get in my car and I drive over there and I'm looking at trophies. They say, well, here's one that doesn't cost very much. I said, no, my son's is bigger than that. They said, well, okay, here's a bigger one. I said, no, I'm looking for one that's really twice as big as Daniel's. You know, something I could just rub in his face, make him feel like crud, you know. I need something twice as big as Daniel's. And so I buy this trophy. And I bring it home and I set it right there in the living room. And people come over to our house. They go, wow, what is that trophy for? And my wife says, that is because my husband is the biggest idiot in Tarrant County. Because we know that you don't buy yourself a trophy. If you buy yourself a trophy, it means nothing, right? We don't honor ourselves, right? This is what these guys are saying to Jesus. They're saying, you're just trying to brag. Who are you making yourself out to be? And that's why Jesus says here, if I honor myself, my honor is nothing. But listen to what he says, verse 54. He says, it is my Father that honoreth me. Okay? Now that means something. It is my Father that honoreth me, of whom you say that he is God. Now that means something. You brag about yourself, it's meaningless. Nobody wants to listen to a word you say. But when God starts honoring you, that means something. For example, you think about when Jesus was baptized. After Jesus was baptized, Jesus didn't get everybody to gather around him, start telling them how special he was. No, something much more special happened. The heavens were opened unto him. The Holy Spirit descended upon him like a dove. And the voice of the Father came down from heaven. And the Father spoke and he said, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. Same thing happened up on the Mount of Transfiguration, Matthew 17. The voice of the Father, when he was transfigured before his disciples, the voice of the Father spoke and said, "This is my beloved Son, hear ye him." The Father honored the Son. And that means so much more. The fact is, guys, he is greater than Abraham. He is greater than the prophets. He does know things they don't know. He can give life that they can't give. And the evidence is because his Father honors him in that way, because he's worthy of it. Third thing this morning I want you to notice, the surety of the undesired Lord. The things that Jesus has been saying to them, they haven't wanted to listen to. They've been closing their ears to it like little children on the playground. La, 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 la. I'm not listening to you. They don't want to hear it. But I want you to see in verse 54, it says, his Father honors him. He said, "You say that he is your God, yet ye have not known him, but I know him. And if I should say I know him not, I shall be a liar like unto you, but I know him and keep his saying." And Jesus is, again, he's repeating some of these same truths that have made these men so angry before. Remember, we studied it back here in chapter 7. He's saying to them, "I know God, and you do not know him." And no matter how angry this makes them, Jesus is saying it again. No matter how much they hate him to say it, he continues to look them straight in the eye and repeat it to them. It's kind of like, you know, that story I told you last week about the kid coming up to me and saying, "You stink," you know, and it hurt my feelings, but it changed my life, right? Because I started taking some showers, you know, because I didn't want to stink. I didn't want to be the one that stinks. And Jesus has to look in these guys and tell them, "Guys, I'm looking at you spiritually and you stink. Looking at you spiritually and you stink." He's repeating it. You don't know God. And Jesus adds something here. He says, you know, I could compromise. I could take the easy way out. He says, you know, if I say to you that I don't know him, you know, that's kind of what y'all want me to do. I could just back off like that. I could compromise. I could say, "Okay, guys, I'm wrong. You guys are right. And I don't really know God, and you do." Then maybe you guys wouldn't hate me so much. Then maybe you guys would stop trying to make my life so difficult. Things might be a lot easier. But the problem is, if I did this, then I would be a liar just like you guys are. And Jesus says, "I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to lie. I'm not going to water down the truth just to make you guys happier or just to make things easier on myself. I'm just going to look you in the face and tell you the truth, no matter how angry it makes you, even if it makes you want to kill me." And that's exactly what this is going to make them want to do. Kill him. That's what he proceeds to do here. And I want you to notice the truth he's going to confront them with. And this is going to be the biggest thing of all. Verse number 56. Verse 56. Jesus says, "Your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad." Okay, now let's understand what it is that Jesus is saying here, because this is very important. First of all, Jesus used that term, "Abraham rejoiced to see my day." And those words, "my day," that's a biblical way of referring to the day a person was born. If you go back to the book of Job, each one of Job's children, they would each have a celebration in the home, each one his day. Job, when all the trouble came on him and he began to cry out in his pain, he cursed his own day. And this is kind of Jesus' way of saying the day that I was born. Abraham saw my day. It's interesting because Jesus is saying, Abraham rejoiced when he saw the day that I was born. Abraham had been physically dead for over 1,000 years when Jesus said that he witnessed my birth and was glad. And once again, Jesus is pointing us to that eternal life that he's been talking about to these guys. Abraham is not dead. He is eternally alive forever. He may be physically dead, but he's more alive than anybody that's walking on this earth right now. There's another thing that Jesus says here. He says, Abraham saw it. He saw my day, and he was glad. Jesus is making a pretty astounding claim here. He's saying that Abraham looked out from eternity into the moment when Jesus was born, and Abraham was excited about that moment. And that's a shocking statement for these false religious leaders, because Abraham's a pretty big deal to them. Abraham was a big deal to the Israelites, almost to the point that they worshipped him, not quite, you know, but they were really proud to claim that they were descendants of Abraham. And Abraham's a big deal to them. And here is Jesus saying, hey, you know what, guys? I'm a pretty big deal to Abraham. Because he looked at me the moment that I was born, and I could tell he was pretty excited about that moment. He was pretty excited about me getting here. That's a big statement for Jesus to make. And listen to how they responded to that, how they reacted to that statement. In verse 57, then said the Jews unto him, thou art not yet 50 years old, and thou hast seen Abraham? How can you know Abraham? How can you have ever seen Abraham do anything? And that would be an impossible claim for any regular person. It would be impossible for me. It would be impossible for you. But when you're Jesus, the Christ, the very eternal Son of God, then you do know every detail about Abraham's life and every emotion in his heart. You do know every thought that he has. And they're asking, how could you know Abraham? You're not old enough. And I want you to see how Jesus answered that question. Verse number 58, Jesus said, verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am. I am. And did you get that? Jesus is calling himself by that same name again, that name, that ego ami, that I am, that name by which the Lord God has always called himself ever since back to the time of Moses. And he's greater than any of the prophets. He is greater than Abraham. And no matter how much the people argue with him, no matter how much they hate him for it, he still looks them in the eye and he says, before Abraham was, I am. So he's sure. And then finally, this morning, the final point that I'd like you to notice is the strength of the undesired Lord. Verse number 59 says, then they took up stones to cast at him. I told you these things that they were doing were making, the things that Jesus was saying was making them want to kill him. I want you to think about the amazing irony here. These guys are taking up stones to stone Jesus to death. They want to kill him. And I want you to think about the amazing irony, because just a few weeks back when we first started studying the Gospel of John chapter 8, in the very for opening verses of this chapter, what was Jesus doing in chapter 8? Anybody remember? Oh Lord, can these bones live again? What was Jesus doing in John chapter 8, the beginning of the chapter? There was a woman. The Pharisees brought her to Jesus. And what did they want to do to her? They wanted to stone that woman. And so in the very beginning of John chapter 8, Jesus is defending a woman that they want to stone. And now, these same people have stones in their hands and they want to stone Jesus. That is an amazing picture of how Jesus takes the wrath that we deserve, and he bears it in his own body. He takes all the burdens and the wrath that we deserve, and he bears it in his own body. Now they want to stone him. You can get a lot of trouble for telling the truth. I asked my wife this morning if this pink shirt made me look fat. She said, no, it's your fat that makes you look fat. People want you to tell them something easier than the truth. They don't want to hear that they're wrong. They don't want to hear that they've been trying to have a relationship with God the wrong way. But here's the cold, hard truth. And Jesus has been giving it to these guys over and over. There's only one way to have a relationship with God. And that is through faith in His Son, Jesus Christ. It's the only way. He's the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except through Him. There's only one name under heaven whereby we must be saved. You cannot know God any other way. He's the only way. But these men don't believe Him. They're taking up stones to throw at Him because He's been telling them that. But verse 59, we see His strength. Jesus hid Himself, went out of the temple, going through the midst of them, and so passed by. How did He do that? How did He duck? He do some Chuck Norris ninja stuff? How did He have some camo on? What did Jesus do here? Well, the Bible doesn't explain that. But He got out of there. There were a bunch of them. They had stones in their hand. He got out of there just by walking right through the midst of them. The last way that I would plan to do it, well, let's just walk right through them. He walked right through the midst of them, and so passed by. And they want Him dead. And that fits perfectly in with the Father's plan. Don't picture Jesus as the weak one here. They want to murder Him, but it's within His plan. He came to die for us. But there are two problems with what's happening here. The method and the timing. Make no mistake, these men are not in charge of these events, Jesus is. And He will die, but it will be in a time of His own choosing. Amen. And it will be in a way of His own choosing, lifted up on a cross between heaven and earth. On that cross, He's going to look upon these men who are hating Him, crucifying Him, and He's going to see them through the eyes of divine compassion, and He's going to pray for them. Remember that prayer? Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. Even when they're killing Him, it's consistent. Even when they're putting Him to death on the cross in the way the Father planned, He's praying for them. Father, forgive them. See the same thing